real images of what NASA discovered on Callisto. Through Voyager, Callisto, Calliope, Betelgeuse, the neon moons. We're a slow-burning tune, but we'll touch down soon. This is part of the lyrics from Coloratura, a new song from Coldplay. We all know music connects people, and Coldplay is very good at doing so. Their subtle references to space exploration missions, celestial objects, and stars are so evocative and inspiring. It's like they're pushing us towards the future when humanity will be hopefully part of something bigger. Maybe a future in which interstellar traveling will be possible. In the lyrics, there are references to Voyager, the fantastic NASA mission that excited the solar system and was the first human-made mission to do so. Then there are references to Calliope and Betelgeuse. Calliope is an asteroid from the asteroid belt in our solar system, discovered in 1852, and Betelgeuse is a star in the Orion constellation that is going to be a supernova, although we don't know exactly when. If you are interested, you can find out more about Voyager and Betelgeuse at the links in the description. Today, we want to talk about Callisto. This will conclude our grand tour of the Galilean satellites, the four moons of Jupiter. Keep watching to get to know more about the second largest Jupiter moon. So far in our previous videos, we've had the chance to better understand the chemical, physical, dynamical characteristics of Ganymede, Europa, and Io, three of the four Galilean satellites. Each one of them has its own special features, which make it a unique moon. Europa has freckles on its surface. Io is covered with volcanoes that produce plumes of sulfur and sulfur dioxide. And Ganymede has an ocean of liquid water beneath its icy crust. What about Callisto? First things first, where does the name Callisto come from? Well, you should know that according to Greek mythology, Zeus had many lovers. Callisto was one of them. She was a nymph, a beautiful being associated with the goddess of the hunt, Artemis. The name was once again suggested by astronomer Simon Morius, but it was not in common use until the mid-20th century. Before that, they used to call it Jupiter 4, or the fourth satellite of Jupiter. The origin of names is very important from a cultural point of view, but when it comes to astronomy and astrophysics, we need something more. We want to have the entire identity card of Callisto. We wish to know, for example, its distance from Jupiter. As of today, we know that Callisto is the outermost of the four Galilean moons of Jupiter. It is very far from the gaseous planet, orbiting at 1,880,000 kilometers. This is a huge distance, almost 26 times greater than the radius of Jupiter itself. In the videos about Europa, Io, and Ganymede, we saw that all of them experience some sort of resonance, meaning that their orbits are somehow connected in a precise way. These orbit resonances are locking the satellites together, and the tidal locking phenomenon creates some internal structure mechanisms, which could contribute to increasing the heating of the inner part of the moons. However, Callisto is so far from the other three moons that it does not participate in the mean motion resonance. Also, a high distance from the planet means a high orbital period that lasts about 16.7 Earth days, because Callisto has to travel a huge distance before ending an entire orbit. During the years, we've had some missions that encountered Callisto, taking amazing pictures and collecting precious data for us. We will talk about it later in this video, and I'll show you the amazing pictures as promised. But first, it is worth stressing that all of these missions helped us to understand better the physical and chemical properties of the moon. For example, we know that the average density of Callisto is 1.83 grams per centimeter cubed. If you think that the water density is 1 gram per centimeter cubed, this means that on average, Callisto is denser than water. This tells us that it is made of rocky material and water ice, with some additional volatile ices such as ammonia. How do we know that Callisto is made of some water ice? Well, it's all about spectroscopy. When astronomers looked at the moon through near-infrared filters, they found the presence of ice absorption bands suggesting the presence of ice. But this is not the end of the story. More accurate measurements are telling us that ice water is ubiquitous on its surface. Talking about the surface, we know that Callisto is asymmetric. The leading hemisphere is darker than the trailing one. This is peculiar since the reverse is true for Europa, Io, and Ganymede. But we know a lot more about Callisto. For example, we can infer some interior characteristics from gravity field and magnetic field measurements. We found that Callisto's radius is 2,403 kilometers. larger than our moon's radius, and that we can think of its interior as a relatively uniform mixture of comparable amounts of ice and rocks. The surface layer may differ from the underlying ice-rock layer in a variety of ways, including, for example, the percentage of rock it contains. The lack of orbital resonances with other moons, and so the lack of tidal heating, makes Callisto's geological history a really simple one if compared to the one of Ganymede, although the two moons are very similar in bulk properties. We think Callisto has never been heated enough to melt its ice component. However, this doesn't mean we don't have an ocean of liquid water in its interior. This is due to the anomalous behavior of ice melting temperature, which decreases with pressure. This critical temperature is reached in the layer between 100 and 200 kilometers. Also, the presence of a small amount of ammonia almost guarantees the liquid's existence, because ammonia has the magic power to lower the melting temperature even further. And the most interesting thing is that there could be life in Callisto's subsurface ocean. Indeed, a possible subsurface ocean might be composed of salt water. It is possible that some organisms like halophiles could thrive in that ocean. Those are extremophiles that thrive in high salt concentrations. I think we've told you a lot of things about Callisto. Now it's time to talk about exploration missions that give us this giant knowledge and see the real pictures NASA took of this astonishing moon. But first, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel, clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Are you ready? Let's continue. The history of Callisto's explorations start with the Pioneer mission. Pioneer 10 and 11 were two spacecraft that reached Jupiter in the early 70s, but contributed little new information about Callisto, in comparison with what was already known from Earth-based observations. It was only in 1979, with the advent of Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 flybys, that the real breakthrough happened. The two spacecraft, which goal was to exit the solar system, passed close to the moon, and imaged more than half of the Callistoan surface with a resolution of 1 to 2 kilometers. They also measured mass, temperature, and shape. This picture of Callisto was taken by Voyager 1 Tuesday, March 6, 1979, during its approach to Jupiter's outer large satellite. The spacecraft was 350,000 kilometers from Callisto at the time and shows features about 7 kilometers across the surface. The prominent bullseye-type feature in this picture is believed to be a large impact basin, similar to Mare Oriental on our moon. The brighter circular spot is about 600 kilometers across, while the outer ring is about 2,600 kilometers across. This is the first recognized basin in the Jovian system and supports the concept of an old surface for Callisto. The darker color of Callisto, about half as reflective as Ganymede but still twice as bright as our moon, suggested that its upper surface was a dirty ice or water-rich rock frozen at Callisto's old surface. Therefore, with the temperature of about 120 degrees Kelvin or minus 243 degrees Fahrenheit at the equator. After Voyager encounters with Callisto, we had to wait until 1995 to have a second round of exploration. It was 1994 when the Galileo spacecraft flew by it 8 times, the last having taken place in 2001 at a distance of 138 kilometers to the surface. The Galileo orbiter gave us amazing pictures of Callisto. Voyager had a resolution of 1 to 2 kilometers, as we've already said, but Galileo delivered a number of pictures with a resolution as high as 15 meters of selected areas of the surface. The analysis of high-resolution near-infrared and UV spectra obtained by the Galileo spacecraft has revealed various non-ice materials, such as magnesium silicates and possibly ammonia and organic compounds. Here are, of course, some pictures taken from Galileo. This one, for example, shows bright scars on a darker surface that testify to a long history of impacts on Jupiter's moon, as we can read on NASA's website. The picture taken in May of 2001 is the only complete global color image of Callisto obtained by Galileo, which has been orbiting Jupiter since December of 1995. Callisto's surface is uniformly catered but is not uniform in color or brightness. Scientists believe the brighter areas are mainly ice and the darker areas are highly eroded ice-poor material. These four views of Jupiter's second-largest moon, Callisto, highlight how increasing resolutions enable interpretation of the surface. In the global view, top left, the surface is seen to have many small bright spots, while the regional view, top right, reveals the spots to be the larger craters. The local view, bottom right, not only brings out smaller craters and detailed structure of the larger craters, but also shows a smooth, dark layer of material that appears to cover much of the surface. The close-up frame, bottom left, presents a surprising smoothness in this highest resolution view of Callisto's surface, 30 meters per picture element. Isn't it crazy to think that we have pictures of other objects in the solar system with such a high resolution? Last but not least, in 2000, the Cassini spacecraft en route to Saturn acquired high-quality infrared spectra of the Galilean satellites, including Callisto. It acquired high-quality infrared spectra of the Galilean satellites. Also, New Horizon probe on its way to Pluto obtained new images and spectra of Callisto. Before ending the video, we want to say that in 2003, NASA conducted a conceptual study called HOPE, which stands for Human Outer Planets Exploration. This regarded the future of human exploration of the outer solar system, and the target chosen to consider in detail was Callisto. In December of 2003, NASA reported that a manned mission to Callisto might be possible in the 2040s. Building a base on Callisto could facilitate remote exploration of Europa or be an ideal location for a Jovian system way station servicing spacecraft heading farther into the outer solar system, using a gravity assist from a close flyby of Jupiter after departing its moon. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Are you guys in love with Callisto? Let us know in the comments below. See you soon on the channel.